Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you. We praise you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, how we praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Lord, change us, we pray. Hallelujah. Lord, you're the potter. We're the clay. Change us, Father. Becoming more like Jesus. Hallelujah. Iboku shandarariyama shandarariyamaki. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we pray for our Bible study tonight. The life of Christ, as we open the Word of God, we open our hearts. Change us as the song is sung. Transform us by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I want to thank you for joining us tonight, The Life of Christ. It's Antelope Christian Center. It's our midweek Bible study, and we are studying the life of Christ. We're in the Sermon on the Mount, and I have been focused the last few days of my prayer time and my worship time on the subject of growing in Christ. Through the years, I've been able to serve in many different ministries at different levels. I've seen thousands and thousands come to the Lord. I've been a part of great crusades here in the Sacramento region. We've hosted Billy Graham 3 times, but there have been many, many other great evangelists that have been here. People like Joyce Myers, Benny Hinn, even Jimmy Swaggart. Dr. Jeremiah was here only a few years ago. And one of the beautiful things about going to a conference is so many make a decision to follow Christ. They surrender their lives at the arena. The music is so incredible. The enormous crowds are so spectacular. Great moves of God right here in our region. But it's the same in a local church on a Sunday morning. The worship and the visitation of the Holy Spirit, to watch people say yes to Jesus. I was praying with someone recently, and he gave his life to Christ. I was praying with another lady, and she recommitted her life to Christ. Aren't those moments so incredible, seeing people say yes to God? They are. But the difficulty I have struggled with through the years, even though I know the Bible, and even though I know the parable about the seed and the soil, it grieves my spirit. It breaks my heart when I see people fail to grow in their relationship with the Lord. At first, I'll watch and they'll kind of stall, they'll stumble along. Their participation becomes erratic. They don't follow through. You can sense they're not reading or studying God's Word. They've kind of given up on prayer in their own personal time. And then you tragically learn someone has slipped back into their old lifestyle. That breaks my heart. And as I have been studying the Sermon on the Mount, I have been focusing in my own personal study time, on how people can thrive in their walk with God. Let me say it again. How we can grow and thrive in our walk with the Lord. We are either growing or we are dying. We are either going forward or we are slipping backwards. Earlier this week, I had the privilege of marking something off my bucket list. There's a peak I've wanted to climb for many years called Lassen, Mount Lassen Peak. It's in the Lassen National Park, a few hours from here north. Well, I had the opportunity Monday to climb that peak. It was horrific. It was so difficult. The gust of winds at the top of the peak were 60, 70 miles an hour. I thought it was going to blow me off. Over 10,000 feet high. Oh, that was so difficult. Well, I've been preparing for it. I've been training for it. And so many times, that last mile, I just wanted to turn back. I wanted to give up. Later on, after I reached the peak, I would make my descent down. And I would say half the hikers, much younger than me, turned around halfway up because of the wind and the degree of difficulty. We are either going up or we are going down, but you cannot sit still. Do you recognize in your walk with God you are either growing and being drawn closer to Him, or you are drifting away? Someone made the simple notation that God hasn't moved. If anybody's drifting away, it's not the Lord. We become distracted. Doubt grows in our heart. We deal with the monotony of life and being in lockdown and the politics. And if we don't stay fresh in the things of God, we will grow cold. One time a church family started skipping church. The pastor made a house call to check on the father of the home, who was a dear friend of the pastor. He said, "I've missed you in church." They were in the living room and the fireplace was going that winter night, and the man said, "Yes, I've been really, really busy, Pastor. I normally don't miss, but I just have other things that have been coming up." Well, the pastor didn't lecture the man. He didn't scold the man. He just grabbed those things on the side of the fireplace that you use to stir the logs, and he reached into the hot, flaming fire. And he pulled out a red, hot piece of wood. It wasn't large. It was about this big. And he pulled it out of the fireplace. And he set it there on the brick decor in the front. And he just left it there. And he studied it and he watched it. Several minutes went by. Obviously, it began to smolder. The smoke was rising, that red hot went out, and eventually, of course, it grew cold. And that's how it is in the family. That's how it is in our walk with God. We're either on fire for the Lord, we're either committed in our hike up a peak, or we start sliding down. We start giving up without saying a word. The pastor, once the little coal had gone out, looked at the church family member, and the guy said, "I understand what you're saying, Pastor. You'll see me Sunday." And you know, that's a beautiful lesson of my personal intimate walk with God, not just yours, but my walk with God. And I'm going to show you that tonight. It can happen to a pastor. It can happen to a board member. It can happen to a great Bible teacher. It can happen to a television evangelist. They're on the air and they're showing everybody their walk with God and writing beautiful songs. But inside, things can grow cold. And it's so vital that we stay fresh and we listen to the words of Christ. I could bring you many, many books I've read and what he wrote, what she wrote, but I want to stick to the Bible. I want to stay with literally in our study of the life of Christ, what Jesus taught you and I about how to grow in our intimate relationship with him. And you will recognize in the eight Beatitudes, there are four areas that Jesus deals directly with our vibrant walk with him. Now, as we look at the Beatitudes, I just going through the New Testament this evening, I want to remind you what Peter the Apostle would write. You'll find it in 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. Like newborn babes, Peter wrote, long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow. That by it you may grow. A beautiful word study I had the privilege of doing this afternoon was that word grow. And I was inspired when I read 1 Peter and how he was writing about long for the word, the milk of the word, that you may grow. I was inspired by those words. And so I did a word study on the word grow. So many times Paul the Apostle writes, I am praying for you. He'll write to a church in Corinth, a church in Philippi, a church in Thessalonica, a church in Rome. And so many times in his letter, he will include this notation, I am praying that you are growing in your walk with the Lord. The author of the book of Hebrews provides for us not only the inspiration to long for the appetite of the milk of God's word, but to also look for the meat of God's word. Now, most translations, you will find the word solid food. It's speaking not of the milk, it's speaking of the meat. And let me just pause right here and say that we need in our healthy diets both milk and meat. And anyone that says, I don't need the milk of the word, they're missing an important part of our spiritual diet to stay healthy. Now, in Hebrews, I draw your attention to Hebrews chapter 5. It says, in fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you should be growing, you actually need someone to teach you the basics of God's word. You need or require the milk, not solid food. Now, there's two dynamics, and again, I don't want you to miss it. An infant can only swallow milk, not solid food, not meat. But secondly, a young person growing up, and I raised three teenagers, and I don't know what happened when they hit 13 to 19, they went through the milk. They didn't just eat solid food, but that growing healthy body needed both the milk and needed the meat. Don't neglect the milk, but also recognize the meat of God's word. Peter writes about growing. The author of Hebrew writes about growing. One of my favorite writers in yours too is King David. Consider for a moment what King David wrote in Psalms chapter 1. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, or stand in the way of sinners. But blessed is the man who delights in the law of the Lord, and upon the law of God's word they meditate day and night. As we've been reading through the Beatitudes, we've discovered four qualities that Jesus spoke of for you and I to stay on fire for Christ, to stay ablaze in our intimate walk with Christ, to stay fresh in our worship, in our fellowship, in our prayer life. There are four areas that are addressed in the Beatitudes. Let's review them. Blessed are the poor in spirit. That's something that happens inside of me. Blessed are they that mourn. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst for righteousness. And finally, blessed are the pure in heart. Pure in heart. Let's get started there. David would write in Psalms chapter 24, "Who shall ascend to the mount of Zion, the mountain of the Lord? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart." When you buy a car and it's brand new, it looks so shiny and beautiful. I was getting my oil changed the other day, and they were selling brand new cars. Boy, they were trying to get me to buy a new car. My little Subaru has 155,000 miles on it. Oh, you need a new car. So I listened to the salesman as they changed my oil. One of the things that caught my eye about those brand new cars is how they hired people to keep those new cars looking so shiny. You see, in just 24 hours, they're out there washing those cars all over again. You drive by any new dealership where they're selling new cars, and that's right, you will see somebody washing a new car. That's kind of funny to me. Why in the world does a new car needs to be washed? Well, if it's in this world, it's going to get dusty and dirty. If a car that's never been driven needs to continue to be cleaned, how much more does my soul and my spirit need to be renewed? Sometimes you can kind of tell what's going on in somebody's heart and their thoughts by listening to them talk. When people talk trash, when they use crude language, those words, that conversation of gossip, malicious words, that comes from their thought life. And those thoughts come from the heart. Follow it. If it's not in the heart, it won't be in the thoughts. And if it's not in the thoughts, it won't come out in words. The words reveal somebody's heart. The words reveal somebody's thoughts. The thoughts reveal somebody's heart. What did Jesus teach? If I'm going to stay vibrant in my relationship with Christ, I need to keep a pure heart. And how can I do that? Well, we've been reading from the writings of Peter, the writings of David, and even the writing of the author of Hebrews, that we must grow in the Word. One of the most overlooked passages of Scripture in the Old Testament is guidelines for Israel
should they ever have a king. I'm speaking, of course, from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 17. God is guiding Israel for the day that they would ask for a king. And God said to them, "You must appoint someone from Israel. Never appoint a foreigner to be king of Israel." That happens even in our own country today. You cannot become president unless you're from the country you want to be leader of. God is laying these things out. The king must not build a large stable of horses, and that's so that he won't look to the horses instead of God. Don't get too many wives. Be careful of your wealth. Don't accumulate too much. It'll distract you from your walk with me. And here it is in verse number 18 of Deuteronomy. We're studying how to stay in a thriving relationship with Christ. As Christ taught in the Beatitudes, to have a pure heart and a hunger and thirst for righteousness. That's what Jesus taught. And God, in his words, thousands of years earlier, laid it out. And he said, if you ever have a king, these are the things the king must not do, and these are the things he has to do. I'm speaking from Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 18. You're going to want to study this. Write the chapter and verse down. Find it in your Bible and study it very carefully, because it has to do with your relationship with Christ, my relationship with Christ, and how to have a pure heart and a hunger or appetite for righteousness. When the king sits on the throne, he must have for himself his own copy of the scriptures. He must always keep a copy of the scriptures with him. He is to keep a copy of the Bible wherever he goes. And it is required, if he's going to be a godly king, that the king read for himself the Bible every day. Isn't that remarkable? Do you know God set into motion a law for the king of Israel? Saul, David, Solomon, and even during the divided kingdoms, each king was responsible for having his own Bible and to read that Bible each and every day. I was speaking to a young person the other day, and I asked them, I said, do you like coffee? Do you drink coffee? And they said, no, I do not drink coffee. I said, that's odd. I drink coffee every day. Is there a biblical reason that you don't drink coffee? And he responded to me, no, I've never acquired a taste for coffee. Isn't that interesting? I've had the habit of a morning cup of coffee for so many years, I don't really recall acquiring a taste for coffee. I just always remember drinking coffee. Our conversation shifted gears, and he was talking about some of his friends, and he began to share with me how they drank alcohol. And I asked him, I said, well, your friends drink alcohol. I said, do you drink alcohol? And he kind of smiled and was a little sheepish. And he said, yeah, I, He said, I drink beer quite often. I said, well, aren't you a little young to be drinking beer? He said, yes, I shouldn't do it, but I like it. Well, I connected the dots from what he said about coffee, and I asked him. I said, the very first time you drank beer, because he's a young person and he could remember, I said, did you like the taste of beer? And he said the oddest things for me. He said the oddest thing to me. He said, no, I didn't like beer when I started drinking it. I had to acquire a taste. I walked away much wiser after listening to that young man teach me about coffee and alcohol. He's probably right. You have to develop or acquire a taste for coffee. And in all likelihood, just like him, you probably have to acquire a taste for alcohol. I became much wiser as I began to ponder the things of God and the things of this world. Just because you take a bite of something and you maybe don't care for it, doesn't mean it's not good for you. And when it comes to reading the Bible and studying the Bible, it didn't have to do with the taste of the king. It had to do with an edict from the King of Kings. God said, I ordain you to study and read the Bible every day to every king. And sometimes you have to acquire a taste. Let me give you some help tonight. Do you read the Bible every day? Do you read someone's devotional every day? Reading devotions are excellent. They're very, very good. What a devotional is someone else has read the Bible and they tell you what they think of the Bible. As you grow in your walk with God, someday you will pick up the Bible without the help of anyone else and you'll simply read the Bible for yourself. Are you doing that today? Are you reading the Bible? Can you open up to the book of Matthew, the book of Psalms, the book of Romans, and just sit down and enjoy feasting on the Word of God? Now, if you can't, don't be sad. You acquire a taste. I've been reading the Bible for a few years, and I have a taste. And every time I read the Bible, I'm so amazed. I discover something brand new. But I've acquired a taste for both the milk and the meat of God's Word. Let me take it to a second level. If you don't read the Bible every day, it's possible that your translation isn't connecting with you. And I want to encourage you to just kind of shop around. And we are blessed in the last 100 years of having so many wonderful translations of the Bible. The New International Version, the New American Standard Bible, oh, they are excellent. And a very modern translation of the Bible is the New Living Translation. It does not have the tone or the cadence of a King James. But again, reading the Bible so that you have a taste for it and you're understanding the story. If those still don't bring you to that place of understanding them, look around for a paraphrase. The Living Bible, when I picked up a copy of that as a teenager, I sat down, got so excited, I read it cover to cover. That's right. The first time I read the Bible cover to cover, it was through the Living Bible. It came alive to me. I understood the story.
If you're going to have a pure heart, if you're going to thirst and hunger for righteousness, you have to stay in the Word of God. There's another modern paraphrase called the Message Bible. I read the Message Bible probably each and every week. I was reading it today. It has such insight. It's not a King James. Let me share with you what I was reading today. In King James, the Bible is translated, "Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are they that mourn." In the Message Bible, when I was reading through it, I actually wrote it down. It says, "Blessed are you when you are at the end of your rope." Like I said, it's a paraphrase, but it makes the point. That's what it is to be poor in spirit. I feel like I'm at the end of my rope. Blessed are you when you feel like a failure and you just can't go on. You're mourning. All I'm saying to you tonight is find a Bible. Be in the Word of God. Study the Word of God. Have a pure heart. Develop a taste, an appetite, a thirst for God's Word, for righteousness. Thanks for joining me tonight in the life of Christ as we are reading and praying through the Beatitudes each and every day. Always remember that God loves you and so do I. And would you help me? There's somebody in your life, maybe a family member or a friend. They don't feel loved by anyone. Would you tell them? Would you just tell them God loves them and let them know that you love them too? Be blessed. Father, I bow my heart to you and I ask you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that your favor would come upon each and every one. Lord, that your peace would be within each heart. I pray, Lord, as you transform us, as you change us, that your Holy Spirit would do such work in our lives. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you.